Das ist unser Rolls Royce. Immer zum Teil. Und wieso ein Rolls Royce auch fliegen kann, das erfährst du in dieser Folge von Swiss Behind the Wings. Herzlich willkommen zu Swiss Behind the Wings. Mein Name ist Michael Stief und heute sind wir bei Rolls Royce. Ich treffe jetzt den Matt und er erklärt uns, wie die modernen Triebwerke von unseren A350 zusammengebaut werden. Komm mit! Hello, Matt.
Hey, Michael. Good to see you.
Good to see you. Thank you so much for having me here today.
No, you're welcome. And welcome to Rolls-Royce. Welcome to the home of Rolls-Royce here in Derby. I'm delighted to have you with us today. I'm going to share a little bit with you about more of the Trent XWB powering the A350, soon to join you in Swiss. Super excited to show you a little bit about how we make those engines, what's behind the surface of our engines. But first of all, I'd like to take the opportunity to share a little bit of history.
Sure.
So my own history, I've been working here for nearly 30 years with a wide range of experience across engineering and etc. But the history of our company is much deeper. So let's scratch the surface a little bit of the 120 years of history of Rolls-Royce and what makes our products great. Come on inside.
Amazing, thank you.
So as I said, Michael, we're really proud of our history here at Rolls-Royce. And this is our company museum that just gives a little slice of the 120 years history from Rolls-Royce motor cars.
What we know. Yeah.
What we know, what we understand, exactly the part of our history now, but through to the engines that we support our customers with today. And it comes really back down to the two gentlemen in front of us here.
Mm-hmm. Nice to meet you.
Yes, indeed. So Sir Henry Royce, the real engineering brains behind the organization. Yes. And his motto was to find the very best that exists and then make it better.
Oh.
And that's what introduced him to Charles Rolls, who was real motoring enthusiast and actually an early pioneer of aviation. And it was the success or the joining together of these souls that really set our company on the path forward that we find ourselves on today.
Oh, amazing, okay.
And so continuing our story about history, Michael, the engine we're walking past here is that's the start of the modern commercial aero engine for Rolls-Royce, the three-shaft RB211 engine. Another engine from my history, a much smaller engine, but super powerful. This engine actually powered Concorde.
Oh, wow, it's very small.
It's very small. So this engine, designed for speed, designed for power, thrust. It's all about the thrust with this engine, but much less efficient than those larger gas turbine engines. And here we come to the engine of today. The Trent XWB 84.
It's massive.
Massive, much larger than the Concorde engine, much larger than the RB211. But this larger fan, this relatively small core of the engine, that enables us to deliver that really high fuel efficiency that we enjoy from the Trent XWB 84.
But for me, like an engine, it's pure magic how an engine can work, you know, give this huge amount of thrust. Can you just explain to me a bit how an engine works?
So let me walk you through from front to back to explain that in a bit more detail. So the front of the engine, this 118-inch fan, 3 meters in diameter, that's pulling in over 1.2 tons of air per second when this engine's operating at maximum power.
So really, how much is that?
So if you play sports, think about the size of a squash court.
Yes.
So this engine is swallowing a squash court full of air every single second. Massive amount of air, because that's where the thrust is coming from. Best way to think about it, an engine like this is actually pulling the aircraft through the sky.
Yes.
We talk about bypass ratios with these modern gas turbine engines. That's the difference between the air that just simply passes through the fan versus the air that goes through the very core of the engine, the center of the engine.
Which is much smaller.
Much smaller, the ratio of the size of the front of the engine to the rear of the engine, that really reflects the bypass ratio.
Can we say, so this is not the engine?
That's true. This is not the engine. This is just the very front piece of the engine. The real power source of the engine is what sits behind.
I see.
What we would call the core of the engine. Mm-hmm. So the front part of this engine is dedicated to separate rows of rotating compressors, we would call them. You could think of them as fans. Mm-hmm. And gradually we're restricting the airflow in a smaller and smaller space. So that's, think about taking the amount of air in a phone box and squeezing it into a shoebox.
Oh my God.
Okay. So that amount of reduction. Or I love a much better analogy, if you took all of the passengers from two double-decker buses and got them into a small car like a mini.
Oh wow, that gives a lot of energy, a lot
exactly.
of anger.
So think about that energy that we're just putting into that air as we compress it in the front of the engine. Then, as I said, we introduce fuel in the combustor of the engine, right in the heart, right in the middle of the engine in front of us here. So we introduce the fuel. The fuel is ignited. It's a continuous cycle. This is always running, always happening. And we burn the fuel in that incredibly energy-rich air that we've compressed. The temperature inside the combustor of an engine such as this, pretty much half the temperature of the surface of the sun.
Oh, wow.
Hugely inhospitable atmosphere that we're creating inside of this engine just to generate that power, to drive this fan, to deliver the thrust, to make that Swiss aircraft fly with all of those passengers
yes.
quietly enjoying their champagne and,
exactly.
and beautiful food.
Not knowing what's going on.
Knowing what's
outside.
Going on right just outside, there is something burning with half the temperature of the sun, but doing it in an absolutely safe and reliable
and quiet,
and efficient
also.
And quiet as well, super quiet. Mm-hmm. So once we've ignited the fuel, we're then onto the final phase, the blow phase. Yes. And this is where we extract the energy from that gas flow, from that mix of air and fuel, enough energy for us to turn the fan at the front of the engine here and generate all that thrust that we need to power the aircraft. Just the first stage of this turbine, we're operating in an environment that is higher than the melting point of the materials that we use inside there. And so we do that with a number of ways. We can coat the material with protective coatings, but we also use cooling air. I say cooling air, the air that we use to cool the turbines is incredibly hot.
But how hot is it?
The cooling air could be 500-600 degrees C. So
freezing.
It would burn a hole straight through you, but it's cool enough. The difference between the hot gas flow that's just come from that combustor, it's cool enough that it's just enough for us to protect that material. And the analogy I like, so the cooling challenge as I refer to it, Michael, if you were to open your freezer at home and take an ice cube and put that ice cube in the oven in your kitchen.
Yes.
And prevent that ice cube from melting with your oven turned up high for 5 or 6 years. That's the challenge that these engines undertake every hour that they fly,
really
every
possible.
Day that they operate. And they do so, as I said, for 5 or 6 years in a typical customer operation.
This is so fascinating.
Here you can see we have 24 of these fan blades. Mm-hmm. So this blade itself weighs, what, probably 15, 20 kilograms?
Uh-huh. That's okay.
That's okay, it's relatively light, but it's incredibly strong. Mm. At full power, the fan on the front of the engine will be rotating at about 3,000 RPM, so 3,000 revolutions per minute. And the force that's exerted on these blades because of the work that they're doing on the airflow, because of the weight, that 20 kilogram weight, mm-hmm. It's about the same as each individual blade supporting the weight of 9 double-decker buses. So a 90-ton load is being exerted on these components.
They must be so strong, huh? They must
absolutely be so strong. Uh-huh. Absolutely strong. Designed absolutely for purpose. Tested to absolutely confirm that these blades will remain robustly intact and doing what they do for the whole life of the engine.
That's already a very fascinating insight. Thank you so much. Now I understand a little bit how an engine works, but now I want to see how an engine is being produced.
Absolutely, Michael. Well, it'd be my pleasure to take you to our production facility and actually walk you through how we put together an XWB and all the processes behind it. So come with me, let's go.
Okay.
And so here we are, Michael. We're inside our production and test facility. So this is one of the most advanced facilities of its kind in the world. This is where we start the process of assembling, final bringing together our engines to make them into those wonderful things that power and will power the Swiss A350 going forward.
Cool.
So walk with me and I'll show you a little bit of how we do that. You could think of it like a flow line.
Like a car
assembly, exactly. So we start small.
Yes.
And when I say small, you can think of all of the individual components it takes to build an engine. Mm. Nearly 30,000 parts go into an XWB engine.
And also, as I see, it's really... Everything is handmade, no?
Well, that's right. It's these are complex engines, and we need to achieve the control of each individual process, each individual installation. So they're very much hand built, literally hand built from start to finish. Engineering is a wonderful science, isn't it? Because it never stops.
Yes.
We don't stop at the XWB. People tell us this is the best wide-body engine that's been made. This is the best wide-body engine that's in service today. Mm-hmm. But we don't stop there, because that's the joy of engineering.
Yes.
Because the minute you finish something, everything you learn to that point, you then think, I could reapply that knowledge. I could go back to the beginning and come up with something even better.
And that's also a bit the spirit of Mr. Royce.
Precisely. And I love the quote that was attributed to our founder, Sir Henry Royce, that says, you find the very best thing that there is, and you find a way to make it better. And that spirit still lives with us here at Rolls Royce.
I can feel that. Yes, really.
Yeah, for sure. No, it's great.
So, Matt, what makes the XWB 84 so special?
I'll tell you what, Michael, let's just get a little bit closer to this engine and I'll talk you through some of the key points. So here we have XWB engine pretty much ready to go. Just needs to go for its final test, then we'll dispatch it off to the customer.
Uh-huh.
But the key behind the success of the XWB, the key what makes it so special, as you asked me, is really goes all the way back to the start. We started the XWB and the A350 project with Airbus back in 2004. We were looking to rise to the challenge of the aircraft that really set a new standard in twin-engined long-haul aviation. We took our time because we wanted to make a big impact. And that big impact was to deliver, through the A350, an aircraft that was 25% more efficient than the 777. That efficiency came through the airframe, but also came through the engine. Really making a step change in fuel efficiency, which is important when we consider aviation, the world that we are, and the contribution that we make to the environment. Yes. So delivering an airframe between us that was 25% more efficient than what had gone before was a real significant step forward.
So Airbus didn't come with just an airframe and said, okay, build us an engine for this airframe. It was a collaboration.
Absolutely a collaboration. And I think that's one of the key reasons why when people turn to us and they say, you know, this is probably the best aircraft engine combination that's been brought to market in recent history, it's through that close collaboration.
So Matt, before you said the fascinating thing about engineering is it never stops. There's always coming something new. So how's the engine of the future looking like?
Well, one clue might be right behind us here.
A huge clue.
A huge clue.
Yeah, it's amazing. Uh-huh.
So this is an exact scale model of our UltraFan demonstrator. So much, much larger than the XWB that we saw earlier. So really supersizing the front of the engine to deliver even greater propulsive efficiency. So we'd expect this engine to deliver double-digit fuel efficiency improvement relative to the XWB.
Thank you so much for that really fascinating insight into the world of engines. And all the best.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Matt.
Cheers.
Ciao.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye. Wenn ihr gli in unserem A350 sitzt und euch beim Start leicht in Sitz drückt, dann wisst ihr jetzt ganz genau, was es alles braucht, damit das Flugzeug in die Luft kommt. Schön, seid ihr dabei gewesen bei Swiss Behind the Wings. Bis bald.